Good morning. I'm David Young with Verizon. We're proud to sponsor State of the Net. I also serve on the board of the Internet Education Foundation. Today, I have the honor of introducing a distinguished member of Congress who's been a real leader in the communications and technology policy area, Congressman Bob Latta, representing Ohio's 5th District. Congressman Latta is the ranking member of the Communications and Technology Subcommittee of the House Energy and Commerce Committee, which is going to put him at the forefront of important issues like spectrum, stellar reauthorization, rural broadband deployment, and yes, of course, net neutrality. He is recently the past chairman of the Digital Commerce and Consumer Protection Subcommittee. We are honored to have him here today, and we look forward to his remarks. Please join me in welcoming Congressman Latta.
Well, good morning, and thanks very much for allowing me to be here. This is the first appearance I've made since taking over the leadership role on as the Republican on the Telecom Subcommittee, as we kind of call our Communication Technology Subcommittee. But I also want to thank the Internet Education Foundation for hosting today's event and for all of you attending today. So I look forward very much to getting to work. We have so many issues that we're going to be dealing with, and with my friend, the chairman, Representative Doyle from Pennsylvania, who I know that you heard from earlier today. I'm not sure if you got in a little bit about energy and commerce, but for us to serve on it, you know, it's the oldest committee in Congress, in the House, and we all believe it's really the most important committee that there is because we have the broadest jurisdiction. More bills come out of our committee that are signed into law than any other committee. And I know that our chairman in the last Congress, Greg Walden, always points out the bipartisan nature of the committee, and that we put out about 94% of our bills that went out of committee were bipartisan. And of course, more bills that were signed into law came out of our committee. So we've got a lot of things that happen, but it's also a great committee to sit on because when you're sitting there, you get to listen to all the folks that are coming in from across the country, maybe even across the globe, talking about what's happening. And it's always important for us to always remember this because what we're looking at is from industry and the folks out there who are the innovators, they're not looking at the rearview mirror. They're not looking at the end of the car. They're looking 5 to 10 years out. So when you're talking with regulators, it's just so important, or you're writing legislation, that we're not putting up types of roadblocks that are going to stop that innovation from occurring. So it's very, very important that we always remember that because, again, we want people to be out there innovating, not worrying about, you know, what's going to happen in their term as to more regulations that might be put on them. I know when I've gone to a lot of tech startups, one of the things that I always point out to folks when I get back, you know, they've got a lot of folks that might be working in a large room, but you usually don't have in the corner of the room the person who's doing their compliance work. That's not something they're worried about at the time. What they're worried about is getting that product out to market and getting it out to folks. Also, in the 114th Congress, Peter Welch from Vermont and I had the Internet of Things Working Group. We had 6 different meetings that we had. We had across the board, when you think about all the different areas, from on financial services to manufacturing to healthcare to agriculture to autos. We went down the entire list to have folks come in to talk with us. But the one thing that they all said, and I could have been blindfolded, I would not have known what industry that they were working or trying to get their product into, because they all said the same thing. We're not against regulations, but they all said the exact same thing. Give us soft touch regulations that we can live with so we can go out there and innovate. So I think it's really important that we remember that as we go forward. And I think it's also important that when we look at what we've accomplished, especially in the last Congress, because again, with that bipartisan effort that we did have, we got out the Ray Baum Act last year, which was the most comprehensive telecommunications work in the last 2 decades. So we want to build from that success from the Ray Baum Act, and I'm confident that we can do that and work together in the committee to make sure that we can get that done, and especially in the subcommittee. And today I would like to specifically address 3 issues within the purview of our subcommittee. It was already brought up, net neutrality, how our work on self-driving cars will help speed deployment of 5G and wireless carriers' protections of consumer privacy, especially in the geolocation information. First, the topic of net neutrality. And the term bipartisan always isn't usually associated with the subject, but the truth is there's room for consensus on that. And we've seen the internet function under the different regulatory regimes within the broadband providers being regulated under Title I of the Communications Act for the past 15 years, but also when it was operating under the Title II regs for about 2 years. And since Chairman Walden spoke at this event last year, soon after the FCC did reclassify the internet service back to Title I, and the internet has continued to function just as before, notwithstanding all the social media commotion. So the past attempts at net neutrality have not broken the internet, but have created a lot of uncertainty. And as you are well know, uncertainty can impact future investment innovation potential. And when you look at the numbers that we saw, the percentages, there was a downturn. And again, as I said, we want to make sure that the innovators are out there innovating and getting out there knowing exactly what the rules are on the road. And it's also that uncertainty, you know, hurts the broadband providers to focus on that, closing that digital divide. And so we want to make sure that, again, we have the right legislation, the right regulations out there. So we want to make sure that they can get out there and get it done. So we want to make sure that we can work together, that we can come up with a bipartisan solution and lays out those clear rules for the innovators. And as the past chairs of the Communication and Technology Subcommittee have put forward, they have put forward proposals in this space, and I intend to keep bringing more ideas to the table. So in my new role, I look forward to working with everyone in this room, as well as my colleagues across the aisle, as we continue to work toward a bipartisan agreement on this issue. And if I could just also emphasize one thing. Since I've been here in Congress and all the years I was in elective service back in Ohio, I truly say this and I mean it. I've got an open door policy. If you ever have questions, ideas, suggestions, please come by, because I want to hear it from you. I can't do my job unless I hear from you in this room. So please, I need to hear from you at all times. And as I was saying, you know, when we were talking about the different rules of the road, one of the issues that I worked on in the last Congress was on the autonomous vehicles. And, you know, I was very, very proud of the fact that we had over 300 different meetings in our committee, in subcommittee, dealing with autonomous vehicles in the last Congress. And we were able to come up with a bipartisan bill that passed out of committee 54-0. And then we were able to get it out of the House on a voice vote, which is pretty unusual to ever have happen on such a very large, complicated piece of legislation. But that was from reaching across the aisle and working with everybody and working with industry and everyone that would wanted to come in. But we got out a very good piece of legislation. Unfortunately, you know, things didn't happen over in the Senate, but we look forward to working again to get this done. Because again, we want to make sure that as we move forward, that we have that opportunity to advance and the safety issues that can be done with autonomous vehicles, because again, it saves lives. We've seen, you know, unfortunately, an uptick in our traffic fatalities across the country. It's about 37,000 in the last year. So we want to make sure that innovation is helped and moving forward out there and encouraged. So as companies develop the technology for self-driving cars, they're not just focusing on the technology inside the vehicle. Some companies are working on improving the technology that we'll use to communicate with the outside world, including strengthening our communication networks. So self-driving cars are just like one of the drivers for building a nationwide 5G network. But the promise of a wireless broadband traveling even faster than existing networks holds great promise for the future of connected devices, including self-driving cars, not to mention helping to close that digital divide. So again, last Congress, we enjoyed great success in facilitating the development and of the 5G networks in the United States, and I'm confident we can keep that up in the 116th Congress. But last but not least, I want to also talk about an issue that's been in the news recently, as we've been talking about, the issue about privacy and consumers' geolocation information. And, you know, it came to our attention last year and again early this year that wireless consumers' real-time geolocation data is sometimes shared with third parties. There are many valuable pro-consumer uses for that location data that we've all become familiar to. And those, everything, the number one thing when you talk to the folks in the industry, it's roadside assistance, it's fraud monitoring, it's life alert services. So there's a lot of folks out there that do rely on that geolocation data, and in these approved cases, consumers were given notice and consented to sharing their location information. However, it appears that not all the parties who had potentially had access to the consumer's location were providing such notice and obtaining that consumer consent. So we're in the process of engaging with our Democrat colleagues and learning more what is going on by asking the parties involved for more information. We want to make sure that we are preserving consumers' access to desirable and at times life-saving services while also protecting their privacy. And again, it's important because I lost my mom about a year and a half ago, but when she had fallen earlier and broken her hip, she had a life alert on. And she was at home and she was living independently, but she was able to press that button and the emergency services were able to be there. So again, you know, when we look at these things, you know, sometimes people want to throw the baby out with the bathwater, but it's important to remember all the different things that can be done to help the consumers and also to save and protect lives out there. So, you know, these are the stories that we want to make sure that we hear, but we also want to make sure that the privacy is protected for our consumers across the country. So, you know, we're going to be doing a lot of things in committee this year and a lot of things in subcommittee. I look forward to it. But again, we need to hear from you because, again, I don't learn this by osmosis. And I tell you something else. You know, we get a lot of things that are sent into the office. And as I said, it's so important to hear from you because you can give us those examples that we have to have as we make sure that we produce and legislate the right laws out there, because if we do not do that, you know, we're not doing our jobs. So again, I want to thank you all for allowing me to be with you all today, and I look forward to working with everybody in this room in the future. But thanks very much for your time.